Hi, this is José Luis, and welcome to another video in this series, Introduction to Parametric Modeling. In this video, I would like to talk about meshes, because we've been talking a lot about NURBS geometry and all the properties of NURBS geometry, blah, 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 and why they're so great for freeform modeling, etc., etc. But actually, in a way, NURBS are kind of the exception, and programs that can handle NURBS geometry are also sort of the exception, whereas there is a whole other family of geometry called meshes, which in many fields is actually the predominant geometry type. And what do I mean about meshes? Well, we've seen in previous videos how in Rhino we can create primitive geometry. For example, I can create a simple sphere. Here, and then the sphere will show up, and we can see that it is a perfectly smooth sphere because, as we said in previous videos, it has an underlying mathematical representation with a polynomial and with like equations that define where each point on the sphere is. And therefore, it's a mathematical entity that is perfectly smooth and perfectly continuous. Now, this is actually not the norm because we can also generate spheres by using mesh geometry. For example, in Rhino, I can type here, I can go here to mesh, polygon mesh primitives, and I can click on a sphere. And if I do that, you can see that what I end up with is like this clunky sphere that looks like it has a lot of facets and it does not look smooth at all. It looks like almost like I'm gonna touch this and it's gonna hurt me because it's all pointy and stuff, right? This is because the way mesh geometry works is significantly different at the root, at its core, from NURBS geometry. Meshes, instead of having a mathematical representation called NURBS or whatever model behind them, and then having Rhino use some kind of visualization to display this mathematical representation, that is not at all how meshes work. Meshes work because they are a super, super simple mathematical entity whose only components are the vertices that compose each one of the nodes that are part of the mesh and a collection of faces, typically triangles, but sometimes always also quads, depending on the system that you move in, and a collection of faces that join those vertices in triangular faces or quad faces. And that's it. There's no polynomials, there's no math, there's no things that are derived from this mathematical model, like, for example, the domain of a mesh, or like the parameter of a mesh, or the curvature. None of that applies to meshes. It doesn't, because as opposed to NURBS, meshes are discrete representations of space. What that means is that it's a way of partitioning three-dimensional space with planar triangles in a way that encloses sometimes an enclosed space, but it doesn't really necessarily have to enclose anything, actually. That's actually not correct. But the bottom line is that instead of defining geometry with a set of rules, we define it with a set of partitions, those triangles that are joining a cloud of vertices. What that ends up mean is that, for example, it has some advantages. For example, we can represent things that are coming from the real world because we can 3D scan an object. We can get all the vertices and create a mesh out of those vertices. Whereas with NURBS, it's very difficult to come up with a mathematical representation of an object that is coming from nature, for example. Or certain operations, especially related to graphics and to fabrication, are much easier with a mesh. And actually, I don't know if you know this, but what we see right now here in our Rhino viewport is actually Rhino converting under the hood for rendering this into a mesh so that we can see it visually. But that's a whole different topic. The advantages also are that meshes can be pretty lightweight, actually, depending on how many vertices and how many faces they have. But the downside is that, by definition, they are discrete. So no matter how much No matter how much I would like to create a mesh that has as many faces as possible, so for example, vertical faces, 1,000, and for example, a round faces, another 1,000, even if I do that, and I create a super, super defined sphere that you can see it's very heavy already, even so, at some point, if I zoom large enough, I will see the divisions of these facets, okay? So, and you can see that that object was actually really, really heavy already. So this is basically the difference between nerves and meshes, but let's take a look actually at how can we handle meshes and how can we work with meshes inside of Grasshopper. For example, if I go to the meshes set, you can see that I have a full collection, a full category of meshes for creating primitive meshes. So for example, I can create a box, and then you can see that I get this box, which in Grasshopper doesn't look different from a nerves box at all. Because one thing that we need to do when we work with meshes inside of Grasshopper is to go to display and go to preview mesh edges. I find this very useful to see that, for example, this mesh is actually 10 faces by 10 faces on each one of the 6 sides of the cube, right? Or for example, I can create a mesh sphere. You see that it's very similar in spirit to this one. And I can, for example, make the radius smaller like this, and I can also control how many faces in each direction it has. So for example, 20 faces in one direction, 20 faces in the other direction, and now I have more faces around the perimeter or less. Look at this sphere. This is actually a sphere technically, right? Or I have more faces from pole to pole, right? How cool is this sphere, right? A really low definition sphere. So I can control all of that. And what's important to notice, I could also just bring in a mesh directly from Rhino, right? So I can just place here a mesh empty parameter, right? I can right click, set one mesh, and load one that is living inside of Rhino. And I also get the same, I also get mesh, and you can see that Grasshopper is giving us already like some information. It says that this mesh has 92 vertices and 100 faces. And for the one that we generated inside of Grasshopper, it has 325 vertices and 342 faces. And if I lower this down, you can see that the numbers change correspondingly, right? Now, what is important about meshes? Meshes have a few super interesting properties. Probably the most important one is the vertices and the faces. So for example, the way I can work with that in Grasshopper is by going to the mesh set tab and going to analysis and clicking on deconstruct mesh. We're already familiar with deconstructing points, deconstructing vectors, deconstructing planes. If I do that, and if I plug in this mesh here, you can see that what I get is, first, I get a collection of vertices. So these are all the vertices that are here on the mesh, and I could start playing with those. I could generate, for example, an interpolated curve around them, and you see, this is kind of cool, actually. And remember that meshes, because they don't necessarily have an internal structure, the list of vertices is not given as a data tree. There are no branches here. It's just all the vertices one after the other. And it just so happens that they happen to be sorted in this kind of spiral way. So that's why the interpolated curve is actually kind of cool. Or for example, another super interesting and super important property of meshes is the faces. The faces are defined by the indices of the points that they join, of the vertices that they join. And in order to make this a bit clearer, let me drop here a point list component and let me crank up the dimensions of those points. Oh, that's a little too much. So, and let us see how, you see how the first vertex is down there, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, and then 11, 12, 13, And that is why when I did the interpolated curve, all the curve goes through all the points numerically, okay? But at the same time, you can see that the faces is a very important annotation as well. It's a very important property because you can see that Grasshopper is telling me that this mesh has triangular faces, but it also has quad faces, and quads are actually the biggest ones. And you can see, for example, that there is the first triangle is one that is joining vertex two, vertex zero, vertex two, and vertex one. So 0, 2, 1. The next one is 0, 2, 3. So 0, 2, 3, 2. 0, 4, 3. 0, 4, 3. And you can see how, by looking at the indices, this is how faces are represented for meshes. And if I want to create more meshes, more faces on this mesh, the only thing that I need to do is I need to create faces, giving it the index number of the points that I want to join. Another thing that will be very useful, but this mesh doesn't have, is vertex colors. This is a really interesting property of meshes. Meshes can store color information inside of the vertices. And that is very useful because meshes are actually very popular and very useful rendering. And sometimes if we store that information in vertices, then we can have some predetermined color texture. Texture is not the right word here, just color, some colors that we can start rendering meshes with. Okay, but this one doesn't have. We will do exercises later where we will look at colors and how to use color for our advantages. Those exercises are actually going to be pretty cool. And then another super interesting property of meshes is the mesh normals. And this is actually not a property, it's more of a derived property that depends on the geometry of the vertices and the geometry of the faces that are next to those vertices, because this can actually be computed. The idea is that if we have a vertex and the vertex has the four is connected to other vertices, if I were to add this vector, this vector, this vector, and this vector together, the resulting will be a vector that will be sort of popping out of the mesh perpendicularly to the average of the four faces around it. That is what's typically called the vertex normal. And we can represent that by just going to, as we typically do, we can use vector display, and I can display these vectors anchored in the vertices. And you can see that what I get is all these vertices that are sticking out of the mesh. These normals are super, super useful for a lot of operations, like shading the vertex, like moving the vertex around and deforming it. They are extremely, extremely useful. And typically meshes come with that information, but even if they don't, this can be computed. There are simple rules that allow us to calculate these normals. A similar concept to vertex normals can be face normals. And face normals is typically, I'm not sure about this, it's typically not a property that is stored in mesh information, but it's something that can be calculated. So for example, if I go to analysis and I compute the center normals, the face normals of all the faces on the mesh, what I will get is something like this. I will get, with this component, I will get the centroid of each one of those meshes, and then I'm going to turn this off. I will get the centroid of each one of those meshes, but I will also, if I represent this in 3D with vector display, I can display those vectors at the center of the meshes. You can see that the difference between the vertices, the faces, is that the vector is in a different location. Correction, vectors don't have location. I am representing them in a different location. That's the most accurate definition. But also the orientation is different because the vertex normal is perpendicular to all the edges that are getting to that vertex, whereas the face normal is only perpendicular to the face that it lives on. Okay. Now, this is pretty much it. This is pretty much it. Meshes are, in a way, fairly simple entities, even though the math that the not the math, all the techniques and all the algorithms that allow us to do interesting stuff with math, they are still being developed by mathematicians and computer science. It's actually a really interesting field of study. The only thing, and then there's a lot of things that we can do here, for example, in Grasshopper. We can do primitives, we can work with the information that is inside of a mesh, we can analyze, deconstruct, we can find whether if things are inside of a mesh or not, we can evaluate meshes. There are exercises that we can do with triangulation, like Voronoi and Delaunay connectivity, which is a very popular pattern that has arisen in design in the past few years. And then there's a lot of really interesting properties that we can do with meshes, like adding faces, removing faces, creating projections, etc. And perhaps one of the most useful ones is creating meshes from surfaces. And this is so because it turns out that in a way, nerves are a much more complex entity, mathematically speaking, than meshes. So going from surfaces, nerve surfaces to meshes is actually a fairly simple process. If I have a mesh like this, I can always, for example, make a UV subdivision of the surface and then join those vertices with triangles. It's actually a very simple process. So, for example, if I want to bring in this mesh, this surface here, oops, sorry, let me bring in a surface. I'm going to bring it in. I'm going to bring that in, and I'm going to subdivide that surface into whatever, 10 spans in one direction and 10 spans in the other direction. So creating that subdivision is actually a fairly simple process. And then using that for displaying information, displaying the vertices, or for example, displaying the face normals is a very simple process. So going from a surface to a mesh, it's fairly simple just because it's a very simple subdivision process, whereas the opposite, reconstructing nerves logic out of a mesh is very often not as simple, just because since meshes don't have an internal logic, then it's very difficult to recreate that internal logic. So I think I don't want to talk much more about meshes at this level, just conceptually, but I would like to show how they can be really interesting and the kind of things that we want to do with them with a few hands-on exercises, especially because meshes are very, very popular and they are the de facto geometry entity in fields such as computer graphics, such as rendering, for example. Video games are all made up of millions of triangles. 3D scanning creates point clouds that then we can reconstruct on meshes. And in fabrication, so for example, 3D printing uses meshes, so to do the slicing process and to do the actual printing. So it is kind of important, a very important field. So I would like to do a few exercises to teach you how we can understand them and how we can manipulate them as well. However, in the meantime, if you want to learn more, I have a full 1 hour lecture where I talk about meshes, their properties, and how different they are from nerves in my series, in the lectures in my course Introduction to Computational Design that I teach at the Harvard Graduate School of Design. So if you want to learn more, there will be some kind of link popping up here on the screen, and probably the link will be also in the description of this video. So feel free to check out more on this lecture. And in the meantime, I would like to thank you for watching this video. I will see you on the next videos where I'm going to do a few examples, hands-on examples with meshes. And if you like what you saw, maybe like this video, subscribe to the channel, and all those things that help us keep the message going. Okay, thank you very much, and see you on the next video.